You were able to kind of sit things out by being unopposed and being able to run, but you decided, we had you on the air, to have an 18 for 18. These were people that you had decided to endorse in the primaries that were at multiple levels of office. You endorsed a person running for the school board. You endorsed county council people. You endorsed state legislators. So how did 18 for 18 go for Comptroller Franchot?
I would say that it was a fantastic success, and I just point to someone like Mary Washington, the delegate that won a huge upset over the incumbent senator here in Baltimore City.
43rd District.
I mean,
right,
I'm just happy I live in a state like Maryland where someone like Mary Washington can run against the machine and win. And we had a number of those victories. I think the Annapolis machine, such as I describe it, which is a small number of well-connected insiders that frankly do not work in the public interest all the time, I think they got some direct hits in the primary, and I think there's some opportunity for reform down in Annapolis.
Let's be a little more specific, because while we did see in the House of Delegates the longtime chairman of Judiciary Committee, Joe Valera, you know him well, you served with him, I did as well, he is no longer there. The biggest hits came, though, in the Maryland State Senate, where President of the Senate Mike Miller literally lost his bench, if you want to use a sports metaphor there, Comptroller. You think about the only chairman he has coming back of the standing committees is Bobby Zirkin, the chair of Judiciary Judicial Proceedings Committee, my own committee. But other than that, a lot of new faces down there. So maybe some of the discussions you've been having with the president can change a little bit with a new group down there.
Yeah, everyone knows that all that really matters down in Annapolis is power. And we have the Speaker and the Senate President that have had absolute power for decades. And it simply is corrosive, and ultimately it corrupts. It's not a Democratic or Republican thing. It's just an insider versus outsider. Most of us are on the outside looking in. I'm a statewide elected official. I'm on the outside looking in. And a small number of people behind closed doors in back rooms make the decisions in many issues, like craft beer that you know,
yes,
I'm a champion for, but also things like the Conowingo Dam, which, mm-hmm, is an environmental emergency happening right in front of us. The insiders tend to get their money from corporations, and they pick who their lieutenants are, as you say, and they control the process, and it's to the detriment of the state and the public.
And the reason I'm going to get to the Conowingo issue, because that really is an important one. I talked about my own experience serving from the Senate on this multi-state commission, looking at the Chesapeake Bay, Conowingo, all of it, how it all impacts all of our states in the region, whether it's Pennsylvania, Delaware, or Maryland. But I do want to focus on the fact that there's been a specific attempt to go after you and your office and the powers of your office the last couple of years. Do you believe now, with the kind of changing of the guard, as you get maybe to know a Mary Washington, these younger legislators, that you can kind of put a stop to some of this? It attempts to be, at least from the outside looking in, appears to be kind of personal towards
you.
Well,
yeah, but here's the problem. They can't get at me. They tried to get someone to run against me, and no one would do it. And here's the other problem for them. I know what the secret handshake is. It's money, and that's what makes things work down there in Annapolis. And I'm very comfortable being on the outside with the vast majority of Marylanders, and I'm talking about Trump supporters,
sure,
Clinton supporters, liberals, conservatives, progressives, ultra-progressives, all of us are on the outside. And I don't mean to, you know, overstate the issue, but the primary definitely showed the fact that there's change in the air.
Big change.
Big changes. And it doesn't have to do necessarily with these individual issues or groups. All of us are frustrated with what's going on in Annapolis.
Particularly as it relates, I believe, like you say, the inside versus outside. A lot of people feel like there is this kind of dome over Annapolis that blocks regular folks from having a part to play. Also, Comptroller, as you know, there is a race for governor coming up with Governor Larry Hogan, somebody that at times you do share an opinion, sometimes you disagree with him as well. But you're a Democrat. You said very strong at the very beginning. You're a Democrat, and that you would probably be supporting the Democratic nominee. But right now, you're county executive. You're from Montgomery County. You served there many years. Ike Leggett, I go back with County Executive Leggett when he was chair of the Maryland Democratic Party. Your county executive has decided at this point to kind of stay neutral when it comes to the governor's endorsement, the endorsement of the Democratic nominee, Ben Jealous. What are your thoughts about Ike Leggett kind of staying neutral? And many other Democrats also kind of take a neutral position.
Well, I love Ike Leggett. I think he's just one of my favorite elected officials in the state. He's very thoughtful, honest, open, accountable, accessible. I love the guy. you'll have to ask him what he's doing. I myself, I like Ben Jealous. I've had some conversations with him. I'm going to brief him and his staff on the fiscal matters of the state. I would do that for any gubernatorial nominee. But I've told Ben directly that because of the Board of Public Works, there are only three of us, and because of my relationship with Hogan, I'm going to stay neutral. And I think that's appropriate because it allows me as comptroller to have a good relationship with whoever the governor is.
So your position isn't necessarily based on the Ben Jealous platform, because we've talked about the fact that one of the issues is universal health care for all, could potentially bring a $24 billion bill to the state of Maryland annually. It's not like on issues like that. You're pretty much looking at it from a different perspective.
Yeah, my concern is that we look at issues without the normal, how do we put somebody on the defensive and make them look bad. On the Board of Public Works, we vote on $450 million in contracts every 2 weeks, and it's a big deal. We need to approach it in a nonpartisan, fiscally responsible way, and I want to have that kind of relationship with whoever the governor might be.